Mayor Giuliani, New York's, his position was that he said that the artists whose works are on in the show, he said they had psychological problems. Now here you have another instance of people using mental illness, a disability, to discredit people. And this seems to be a common occurrence. He goes on to say, should not have be having public taxpayers contribute to pedophiles on parade, the mayor told reporters. This should happen in a psychiatric hospital, not in a city-funded museum. There he goes too on that theme that people he don't like, because he doesn't like them, they're mentally ill. And this is how they stereotype and discredit people and everybody who's ever been thought to be mentally ill. And I had this comment by Steve Dunleavy, who has some really beautiful things he says sometimes. He made a comment in the New York Post on October 1st. He said, scientists, doctors, lawyers, and politicians who say, trust me, should be looked at the same way as a tame shark. And I think that's a good lesson, a good rule to follow when you're dealing with these professionals. Comments by Thomas Sowell in the New York Post on October 1st. He said at the height of McCarthyism in the 1950s, when people were having their lives destroyed because they were considered, they were accused of being a communist, there was not as much blacklisting of people as there is today by leftists in academia against scholars who do not share their vision of the world. Try finding a Republican in the sociology department. He also says politics is about power, not about compassion or any of the other mushy stuff that politicians use to get power. Nothing is easier than to get photographed in the midst of smiling children, as both the Clintons so often do. Even Hitler and Stalin were photographed in the midst of smiling children. So it is an old insult to our intelligence to pull this old ploy again at this late date. And then on the same page, John Podhoretz, who is the editor of the New York Post, He wrote a column on October 1st about Al Gore, and his comment was, when a sitting vice president backed by the might of the entire Democratic establishment is forced to declare himself the underdog only a few months before the New Hampshire primary, as Gore did on week ago Wednesday, it might be time to stick a fork in him and say he's done. I thought that was a good analogy. Whether you like Al Gore or not, that's kind of funny. And this is about Fred Thompson's an article, a column by Robert Novak, which appeared in the New York Post, also on October 1st. Fred Thompson is a senator from Tennessee, and he's the one that's been investigating this the disappearance of these pages from the FBI agent's notebook by the Justice Department. Thompson is really aiming at what he calls the shadow government that controls both justice and its nominal chief, Attorney General Janet Reno. He said he calls this an obstruction by justice. After justice was served with a congressional subpoena, somebody tore 27 pages out of an Agent Parker's notebook. And a detailed record of the FBI's investigation was thwarted by the Department of Justice. No Republican in Congress has been more unhappy with Attorney General Reno's perpetual stonewalling when asked for the information than Senator Thompson. But he truly believes she is out of the loop on nearly everything that goes on in her department, and surely is unaware of the defacement of FBI agent notes. Laura Ingersoll, the Justice Department lawyer who headed the campaign finance task force, may be the scapegoat for stymieing the FBI, but Thompson sees a politicized justice triumvirate as the shadow government calling the tune. Robert Litt, Principal Associate Deputy Attorney General, said, Mark Richard, Deputy Assistant Attorney General in the Criminal Division, and Lee Radick, Chief of the Criminal Division's Public Integrity Division. These are not the disinterested career prosecutors that Reno claims to have been running the campaign finance task force. So you see, there are people that are in part of the second level bureaucracy in the Justice Department, as there is in the CIA and the FBI and all federal agencies that effectively run those agencies. The new appointments of secretary, the nominal heads, like the director of the CIA and the Attorney General and the Secretary of Defense and Secretary of Treasury, they really aren't running these things, because the people that have been there for 15 years, they only tell them what they want them to know. And they're able to manipulate and use the person's ignorance to their own advantage. And they keep running these scams. That's where these big scandals come from, the entrenched bureaucracy that's unanswerable to the electorate and to the public. They get there and they sit there for 20 years. Same thing in local police departments. You get a police chief, or in the Cambridge, you have a police commissioner. He's appointed effectively for life. They sit there for 20 years. The elected officials come and go, and they just sit there. And so nobody, they're unanswerable to any abuses. It's a problem all over the country. Local police, there needs to be a more frequent turnover, because you get people in there that have no integrity or have no strength, no moral strength, and the abuses continue, and they become thoroughly corrupt. This has happened in many towns throughout Massachusetts and throughout the country. That's a picture of the fallen church and a demonstration. I don't know if you can see it. Might be able to give me a little more close up here. And what's that? That's about is about protesting the placing of a tower, a microwave tower, on the church. And the people are demonstrating against this. And what I want to, you know, this has happened in a number of communities around Massachusetts. And one of the things that I want to ask is, there are people that are using microwaves on human beings without their consent, and their claim is that it's not been proven to have anything wrong with them. And that has no effect on the people they're using these microwaves on for whatever purposes. For they claim it's the cutting edge of mental health treatment, therapy, whatever. And my question is, if it has no effect, why are they doing it? If there's nothing wrong with it, why are they using it if they think there's nothing wrong with it? And that's where it shows how the government lies. They expose the citizens to all these terrible things, and then they deny there's anything wrong with it. But this is a section from the Massachusetts Criminal Justice Training Council's module training. It's a lesson plan for people with special needs. And one of the things I want to tell you is that they have in here, believe it or not, they have the definition of normalcy. They define what normal is, and this is how they define it. Normalcy is defined by the actions of most community members. Listen to this. Normalcy is defined by the actions of most community members. Now, how do you think they find out what most community members do? Are they watching most community members? I don't think so. The comment on this cartoon, if you can see it, is two women standing at a cocktail party, and one says to the other, "Don't get me wrong, I think the morning after pill is great. It's just that right now my problem is lining up something for the night before."
Right. Well, you don't even need to sit around here.